In the early 80s, Dave Talbot and myself published a trilogy of articles in Chronos analyzing various symbols encoding Venus's recent comet-like history. Although our findings were revolutionary in scope, they were little noticed at the time and have remained so in the meantime. That said, it is my opinion that these early papers represent Dave at his most original and brilliant, and as such, they are well worth revisiting as the bold insights remain valid today and point unequivocally to recent episodes of planetary catastrophism and a radically different solar system. In the articles in question, Talbot and I identified the planet Venus with the Eye of Horus, a novel view at the time but since endorsed by leading Egyptologists. As is well known, the eye is one of the most important symbols in all of ancient Egypt and subject of one of the oldest mythological narratives to survive from that civilization. According to a text known as the Destruction of Mankind, inscribed on tomb walls of various kings from the 19th dynasty, circa 1325 BCE, the eye went on a destructive rampage at the dawn of time that purportedly brought the world to the very brink of extinction. There we read that the eye, as the goddess Hathor, was dispatched by Re to punish mankind. Quote, "Then mankind plotted something in the very presence of Re. Then they said in the presence of his majesty, may the eye be sent, that it may catch for thee them who scheme with evil things. It should go down as Hathor. So then this goddess came and slew mankind in the desert." End of quote. While it would take several volumes to recount the complete history of the cosmic disaster associated with the eye, the following brief summary will offer a glimpse of the mythological treasures awaiting the diligent researcher. In the earliest textual references to the eye, there are a number of allusions to an enigmatic lock of hair. Thus it is that the coffin texts speak of the day of the cutting off of the lock of hair. Another coffin text speaks of that day of cutting off the tress. Yet another speaks of her tress of fire is quenched. Although each of these statements is mentioned in passing as if the story were well known to the audience, the context makes it clear that the fiery lock somehow sparked a cataclysm at the dawn of history. According to one coffin text, for example, the god Shu succeeded in extinguishing the rage of the fiery lock, restoring order to the world. Quote, "I have extinguished the fire. I have calmed the soul of her who burns. I have quietened her who is in the midst of her rage, even she, the fiery one, who severed the tresses of the gods." The reference to the goddess's rage and her who burns is an unequivocal reference to the raging eye goddess Wepsut, renowned for her incendiary, destructive nature. But what does it mean that the eye goddess severed the tresses of the gods? The phrase translated tresses of the gods is sam netcher, wherein sam means lock of hair and is determined with the hair hieroglyph. Yet the former word means mourning as well as lock of hair, and thus Joris Borgitz translates the passage in question as, quote, "the mourning of the gods," end of quote. According to the testimony of this particular coffin text, then, the raging eye of Horus played a pivotal role in the apocalyptic events remembered as the mourning of the gods. Properly understood, the fiery lock of hair has reference to Isis's mourning in the wake of the death of her beloved consort Osiris. Here, Isis is said to have cut off a lock of her hair as a sign of mourning, after which she wandered the world in dishevelment. A hymn to Osiris from the middle of the 2nd millennium BCE offers a general summary of this archaic mythological theme. Quote, "Isis the powerful, the protector of her brother, who searched for him without wearying, who traversed this land in grief and did not rest until she had found him, who sent up a cry, the mourning woman of her brother," end of quote. The same basic tradition is alluded to in the Bremner Rhine papyrus from several millennia later, 4th century BCE. There, in a passage referencing Osiris's murder, remembered as the great mourning and an evil deed the like of which has never been, one reads of Isis and Nephthys that, quote, "they mourn for thee in dishevelment, the hair of their heads is disordered." Evident here are the basic outlines of the Egyptian myth of beginnings, wherein Osiris's tragic death throws the world into darkness and chaos, an event alluded to simply as the disaster. The underlying message is that without the fiery tress, the raging eye departs and begins its campaign of destruction, during which Venus assumed a comet-like appearance, this while displaying disheveled hair and spewing fire from the sky. Isis's disheveled hair is a point of emphasis in several archaic Egyptian texts. Thus, in one text, Isis is described as, quote, swaying her hair like a mourning woman, she being of disordered appearance, end of quote. So, too, the Book of the Dead reports that Isis had disarranged her hair. Quote, I am Isis. You found me when I had disarranged the hair of my face and my scalp was disordered, end of quote. As Talbot and I interpret the myth of Isis's mourning, it has reference to Venus departing the polar axis as a wandering lock of hair, a perfectly plausible pre-scientific description of a comet. Here it will be noted that comets were widely conceptualized as hair stars or as women with streaming or disheveled hair. Significantly, ancient Chinese astronomers described comets as celestial mourning. So too, the famous astronomers held that the planet Venus was in charge of mourning. Additional support for our reconstruction comes from ancient Mesopotamia, where sky watchers described Inanna Venus as an agent of apocalyptic catastrophe, which, like the Egyptian eye, rained fire and destruction from the sky. So too, Mesopotamian astronomers described the planet Venus as the star of lamentation. At this point, the diligent researcher must ask himself why a distant planet moving on a supposedly stable and peaceful orbit about the sun would be described as an agent of destruction or star of lamentation. Certainly it can be no coincidence that Inanna Venus was renowned for her tortured lamentations for Dumuzi, during which she wandered the world in dishevelment exactly like Isis and numerous other ancient goddesses. As is always the case in scientific matters, the devil is in the details. As Talbot emphasized in these early articles, a decisive key is offered by the unique shape accorded the lock of hair. As is evident from its hieroglyph, the lock is depicted as a spiraling volute form. In ancient Egypt, the spiraling lock is most familiar as the distinctive side lock of the youthful Horus. That we are not dealing here with a hairstyle unique to Egypt is shown by the fact that analogous side locks adorn early Mesoamerican gods. Especially telling are prehistoric artworks depicting Venus in Mesopotamia. In the earliest written text in the world, planet Venus as Inanna is denoted by a pictograph showing a spiraling comet-like form. As Talbot and I have argued for some 40 years now, the Sumerian pictograph preserves the unique appearance of Venus during a distinct period of instability that saw the planet depart from its axial alignment within the polar configuration and wander about the axis. The tumultuous period in question, one of the earliest remembered astronomical events in human history, was conceptualized as the departure of the Eye Goddess and the beginning of her campaign of destruction. At the same time, the departure or severing of the fiery lock of hair signaled the death of Osiris and the end of the world age, marked by Venus's period of mourning with disheveled hair. And so it is that comets are associated with the end of a world age around the globe. Early texts from Egypt and Mesopotamia report that the period of Venus's mourning was marked by an apocalyptic darkness. Thus it is that the Egyptian eye goddess was associated with darkness overtaking the world. Quote, the departure of the eye, or Hathor, results in a series of natural disasters in Egypt where perpetual night prevails, end of quote. A similar scenario is described in the magical text of Papyrus Leiden, a text which dates from the early Middle Kingdom. Quote, beware of the mourning of the gods, for then primeval darkness will set in, end of quote. So, too, Sumerian mythological traditions report that a cosmic disturbance associated with Inanna Venus resulted in apocalyptic darkness. Thus, a passage in a hymn to the goddess Inanna credits the planet goddess with the power to make the midday light turn into darkness. Quote, when you are angrily staring, that which is bright gets dark. You turn midday light to darkness. End of quote. Such imagery is extremely difficult to explain by reference to the familiar Venus, needless to say. That said, it is consistent with the planet's role in ancient Babylonian astronomical omens, which point to an intimate association between Venus and the sudden onset of darkness. Quote, as clearly stated in the omen text, the responsibility for the darkening of the daylight is Ishtar's, end of quote. It is doubtless because of the cosmic disaster wrought by Inanna Venus that ancient words for mourning often convey the sense of darkness or a darkening of the heavens or sun. The Sumerian term su-mu-ug is representative in this regard, denoting, quote, darkness, misfortune, calamity, mourning, end of quote. And so it is that Babylonian astronomers described an eclipse of the sun by the term error, denoting mourning. A recurring motif in the Sumerian traditions describing the lamentations for Dumuzi is that the cosmos was thrown into confusion by the tragic events in question. In the following hymns, Inanna's tortured mourning caused the heavens to quake or rumble. Quote, "She of lament, she of lament struck up a lament. The hierodule of heaven, Inanna, the devastatrix of the mountain. She who causes the heavens to rumble, she who shakes the earth." End of quote. Inanna's preternatural ability to shake heaven and earth is a recurring theme in Sumerian tradition and naturally recalls the cataclysmic effects precipitated by the Egyptian eye. The following passage is one of dozens that could be cited in this regard. Quote, "You make the heavens tremble and the earth quake. Great priestess, who can soothe your troubled heart? You flash like lightning over the highlands. You throw your firebrands across the earth. Your deafening command splits apart great mountains." End of quote. The terror inspired by the rampage of the morning goddess was never wholly forgotten and is alluded to in the legendary accounts surrounding the great kings. In a Sumerian hymn dating to the 3rd millennium, the death of the king Ur-Nama is compared to an eclipse of the sun and is greeted by bitter mourning throughout the land. It is in this context that the following passage occurs, quote, "Then Inanna, the fierce storm, made the heavens tremble, made the earth shake." End of quote. The comparison of Inanna, Venus, to a furious storm and star of lamentation, while wildly incongruous as a description of the familiar Venus, is a perfectly apt description of a celestial body whose comet-like hair became disheveled and appeared to whirl about it like a great tornado-like rope. A Sumerian hymn celebrating the morning goddess Geshtinanna captures this image perfectly. Quote, "My hair will whirl around in heaven like a hurricane for you." End of quote. If such archaic mythological traditions have an origin in historical astronomical events, and it is impossible to explain the imagery surrounding Inanna Venus apart from a spectacularly turbulent celestial prototype, it is deducible that it was Venus's whirling hair that darkened the prehistoric skies, thereby ushering in a period of cosmic disorder marked by terrifying storms and the shaking of heaven and earth. And so it is that comets are associated with apocalyptic disaster and the death of great kings around the globe. To summarize, the evidence pertaining to Venus's cometary history encoded in ancient mythology and early artworks will never be explained by reference to the present solar system. The evidence in question is there for everyone to see. And in the final analysis, it is the evidence that will dictate the course of 21st century science.